name is Ms. Correo, and you are all 8th grade students. We are almost at the end of the semester, and we are currently in the middle of our novel called The Eagle of the Ninth. So we're going to do a Nearpod session focusing on mood today. You can enter in the code up there. I'm going to write it on the board as well, so that... exit out. Know you're irritated by something, and so you just kind of make up things to be irritated by because you're just in that mood. I thought it was a good way to introduce mood. So today we're going to be discussing mood in literature, but before we do that, I want to talk about it in real life as well. So I'm sure all of you have used the word mood before in day-to-day life. The phrase that most of you are probably familiar with is, I'm just not in the mood. We say that when we don't feel like doing something, we're not up to whatever the task is. And so mood is actually a really big part of our lives, whether we're reading about it or not. And so to introduce this, I have a collaboration board up here. I'm not sure if any of you have used it before, but basically what we're going to do is you are going to, on the bottom of your screen, you can click on that little picture icon, and you should be able to search up pictures. And I want you to choose a picture that is portraying a certain mood. It can be whatever mood you would like. But try and find a picture that portrays a certain mood, and when everybody's done that, I'm going to try and guess what mood you're trying to portray in that picture. If you need help, let me know. This is the new feature on your pod, so.
So I can use like my picture?
Yes. Haley's got one. Definitely a mood. That girl's definitely portraying a certain mood there. All right, see another one? Yes, certainly.
Yeah.
I hope you're not feeling that way right now. Joyful?
Exactly.
Excited? Let's see. Emily. I want to say angry, extremely angry, not just frustrated. Let's see. I like Lydia's. It's Lydia's too. I'm going to say this one is irritated.
What? Annoyed. Going for, but it was annoyed. Yeah.
Annoyed. Michael, unsure, pensive. Okay, awesome. So you guys have a pretty good idea of what mood looks like in real life, but we are going to look at it in literature because it's a little bit different. In literature, we don't have the luxury of using emojis, of using pictures, of using music and sound, so we have to create it through our words. That's how we create mood. So this is going to start following along in your guided notes. When you take guided notes, it's important to write down what I say, but also if you think of anything else that will help you learn best, write that down too. Because the lessons are always for you, so I want you to learn the best you can. So we are going to define mood to begin with. So the dictionary definition of mood, I have two definitions for you. The first is dictionary definition, and that is the general feeling or atmosphere that a piece of writing creates within a reader. So important words there, feeling or atmosphere that a piece of writing creates. And then I wrote my own definition up there that is a little bit easier to remember, and that is just the vibe of a piece of writing. So mood is the vibe of text, and you will see that as we go through the Eagle of the Ninth. I do want to mention before we move on a difference between tone and mood, because in English, I think a lot of the times those two are mixed up. So I want to clarify before we go any further the difference. So mood is the feeling or atmosphere that a piece creates within a reader. Tone is the author's attitude toward a subject. So we'll start there. Tone is how the author feels about a subject. And mood is the emotions evoked by the author after we read. So the key difference I want you to focus on are the emotion. The mood is the emotions that you feel, and the tone is what the author's attitude is toward the text. So they're kind of coming from two different angles there. When you're done, you can look up. If you want me to repeat anything, I can do that as well. Now we have to find it. So, in an effort to save time, I didn't give you the entire chapter of The Eagle of the Ninth, chapter 8, but I did give you some excerpts. And so I want you to read through that. You'll have about 10 minutes. I know it's kind of a crunch to read through and annotate. But what I want you to do when you're reading this text, you're going to find three examples of mood. The first one is going to be an apprehensive mood, and you're going to be looking for more than just one sentence here. We're looking for kind of like a paragraph on mood that is portraying surgery. So the first one you're going to look for is apprehensive mood. The second one is going to be an optimistic, hopeful mood. And the third one is going to be a nostalgic mood. So this step process is what you're going to do for each of the different moods. And you have a section there on your notes so you can write in what you find. But you're going to read through. When you find a place that you think is portraying a certain mood, you're going to do whatever you need to do to highlight it, whether that's underlining, circling, whatever you feel the need to do. And then you are going to label it with the mood that you find, and you're going to briefly explain why you chose this mood for this section. I do want to point out there are probably more instances of mood than the ones that I focused on. So if you can prove your claim to me, Ms. Renee just talked about proving claims, but if you can prove your claim to me based on evidence in the text, I will accept that as well. I did focus on three specific ones, but yes, that is your task. So you can go ahead and get started. I'll be walking around if you have any questions. But yeah, we're looking for those three specific types of mood and then writing them in our guided notes. And make sure you're thinking about, not only can you identify it, but why did you pick that mood? What in the text is making you decide that it's this mood versus this mood? Looking good so far, guys. Keep it up. Probably about 5 more minutes to keep going through. Try and finish up what you have written. I know it's kind of a short amount of time to read through a chapter, but try and finish up, and then I will call on some people to share what they found. All right, we're going to start sharing. Miss Haley had some good stuff right down back there. Can you share some of what you had? Just pick one of the moods that you found and then tell me why you chose it for that.
For the optimistic and hopeful mood,
yes.
I talked about the paragraph, the first two paragraphs on the back side, because he uses words like lovingly, sunset, light, splashing like golden water, trumpets. Light springing out of the dark. So it's like, I don't know, like he's in this cold, lonely situation, and then all of a sudden, like, all these good, like, hopeful words come up. I don't know, it made me happy.
Yeah, diction. The diction in that paragraph is huge, and just the images of the trumpets, that's really good. That is the paragraph that I had identified as optimistic and hopeful. Do you understand why she chose that? Why she chose that section? The words, like she said, they contrast with the situation that's happening really well. Anybody have anything for the other two? Again, if it's not what I had chosen, if you can prove it, that's great. Yes, Michael.
For nostalgic, I talked about the phrase in the third paragraph where it says, "You pretend that the only mood to look at was half correct now, serve the answer on scroll up going forward." Kind of talking about just looking back at the past and things.
Yeah, that's good. So for that one specifically, you're talking about nostalgic. It's actually the last paragraph, I think Haley identified this one, it's the last paragraph of the text you have, and it starts with the golden light was fading. It just kind of talks about summer changing, and usually when we see a season change, that's kind of means that a character is reflecting back on what they've experienced in the past. So for the sake of time, I'm sure you guys got the last one, or understood the last one, but you guys did a good job in identifying the sections of text that talk about mood. So to move on from that, we are going to end with actually creating our own mood in our own sentence. So you all have a little piece of paper that I gave you that has an adjective on it. I hope you all have that. Do not have that, I will give you one. And so you have a sentence up on the screen here. It's a pretty basic sentence. And what I want you to do with it is create the mood that you have been given on your little slip of paper using this sentence. You can change it and alter it however you want, but you have to show me the whatever words you were given. So some of them are, I think someone has flirty, someone has violent, someone has angry. So just try and move this around and make it portray that mood.
Can
yes.
One sentence.
Yeah, you can do more than that. Yeah. Oh,
it,
yeah, so on your guide note sheet, you have a section that says your turn,
oh.
And that's where you will write your sentence. You can talk to people next to you as well if you want. Chat. Passing out something to just keep writing. Whoa, let's read out loud. I hear you're trying to read to a partner. Let's share them now. What do you have, Miss Sarah?
Okay.
We have to guess.
Yeah.
She's not going to tell us her move.
Isabella could not stop laughing for fear of crying. Her heart had been found, loved, and broken within 1 month, leaving her worse than the day she met him.
What
is that? What's the move?
Can I read it all? No.
It's sad. But
okay.
A heartbreak.
Okay, one more share, because I'm running out on time. Somebody.
Oh my gosh. Mine's okay. Isabella, twirling her hair and batting her eyelashes, couldn't stop laughing as Tommy was whipping out his best jokes.
Yes, so good.
Yeah.
Okay, you guys are awesome. I wish I could have heard more of them, but I am running low on time. So just want to go over what we talked about today. We talked about mood in real life and then mood in literature. And what mood does is it just sets the stage for the text and lets you just understand what you're reading so much more than you would have without it. You have a little exit slip on your desk. It just asks you the most important thing you took from this lesson and then how you can use something from this lesson and take it out to the real world. But that is all I have for you guys. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you had fun. And we'll continue with chapter 9 of Eagle and the Nine.